welcome in the name of the God who created us out of joy. In the name of Jesus who leads us from the way of death to the way of life. And in the name of the Spirit who sustains and keeps us on our journey. It is so good to be here. Thank you for joining us today. Thank you those of you who are here in person with us. A special welcome to our guest, Antoinette, from Ephraim French Seventh-day Adventist Church. It is good to have you here. Thank you also to those of you out there in cyberspace who are worshiping with us, wherever you are and whenever you happen to be joining us. For those of you who don't know me, I'm Pastor Marjo Anderson of Salem Lutheran Church in Bridgeport, Connecticut. To find out more about our ministry or to contact us, you can go to our website, salembridgeport.org, to our Facebook page, Salem Bridgeport, and to our YouTube channel, Salem Lutheran Church, Bridgeport, Connecticut. Links to our donate page and our worship bulletin, which has both the order of service for today and announcements, as well as other resources, are included on our website at salembridgeport.org/live. Links to all of our online events are on the calendar on our website at salembridgeport.org under the Resources tab. Then will you pray with me as we begin our worship? God, you created us to experience joy and love and peace. But the enemy comes to steal and kill and destroy. Thank you for sending Jesus so that we may have life and have it abundantly. Pour the Spirit into our hearts and minds and bodies and souls that we might produce the fruits of love and joy, peace and patience, faithfulness and goodness, kindness and gentleness, and self-control. We pray these things in the name of Jesus, and by the power of the Spirit. Amen.
A reading from the New Testament letters, Romans 10th chapter. The word is near you, and your lips and in your heart. That is the word of faith that we proclaim. Because if you confess with your lips that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For one believes with the heart and so is justified, and one confesses with the mouth and so is saved. The scripture says, no one who believes in him will be put to shame, for there is no distinction between Jew and Greek. The same God is God of all and is generous to all who call God's name. For everyone who calls on the name of the one who is sovereign over all shall be saved.
A reading from the Gospel of Luke. Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan and was led by the Spirit in the wilderness, where for 40 days he was tempted by the devil. He ate nothing at all during those days, and when they were over, he was famished. The devil said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command this stone to become a loaf of bread." Jesus answered him, "It is written, one does not live by bread alone." Then the devil led him up and showed him in an instant all the dominions of the world. And the devil said to him, "To you I will give their glory and all this authority, for it has been given over to me, and I give it to anyone I please. If you then will worship me, it will all be yours." Jesus answered him, "It is written, worship the Lord your God and serve only God." Then the devil took him to Jerusalem and placed him on the pinnacle of the temple, saying to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down from here, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you to protect you, and on their hands they will bear you up, so that you will not dash your foot against a stone." Jesus answered him, "It is said, do not put the Lord your God to the test." When the devil had finished every test, he departed from him until an opportune time.
So always on the first Sunday of Lent, we have the story of Jesus after being baptized, being led into the desert to be tempted. And so today we're going to look at three kinds of temptations and three ways to resist them. The three temptations that Jesus faced are basically the same in each of the Gospels. There's the one about turning stones into bread, the one about ruling over nations, over people, and the one about testing God. As I was reflecting on those this week, it occurred to me that we're really talking about one kind of temptation that has to do with ourselves, one that has to do with the way we relate to people, and one that has to do with the way we relate to God. Let me explain. The first temptation has to do with our physical safety and material comfort. Now, while there's nothing wrong with being safe and comfortable, those comforts can get in the way of our experiencing the abundant life that God wants for us. We get confused because when we think of abundant life, we think of material comforts. And while abundant life can include physical comforts, if we try to find abundant life by trying to get those physical comforts, we're going to miss it. Because that abundant life is a spiritual thing that is not dependent on whether we have physical comfort or not. Think for a minute about why Jesus went into the desert. He went there to fast and pray. He fasted in order to focus on God and not himself. That was his goal. And so if he had given in to the temptation to assuage his hunger, his focus would have been shifted from God to himself, and he would not have accomplished his goal. Often God calls us to do things that involve pain and suffering. We call it taking up our cross. In our lesson, it says that after these temptations were over, the devil left Jesus, but would return at an opportune time. Now, I believe that Jesus was tempted all the time. After all, we believe that he's not only 100% divine, he's 100% human. And if you're 100% human, then you're going to be tempted. But we don't hear a lot about those ongoing temptations. But we do hear about a temptation later on, and that's in the Garden of Gethsemane, when Jesus was praying. And Jesus was saying, God, I don't want to suffer. I don't want to die. Please, let this cup pass from me. But God didn't take the cup away. God had him suffer and die. Why? Because God didn't like Jesus, because God wanted to punish Jesus? No. It was because God had a bigger purpose. And Jesus' suffering and dying was crucial to that purpose. In the same way, we may be called to suffer in our lives. And it's not because God's mad at us or punishing us or because God is, I don't know, kind of a sadist. That's not it at all. Because God loves us. But sometimes God knows that the way to abundant life is through pain and suffering and death. And sometimes it's not so much about our journey, but about the bigger picture, about what God wants to do. I was at a worship service this week, and we were looking at the story of Joseph, back in the Old Testament, Jacob's son. And Joseph had to go through all kinds of things, like the pit and being in jail and horrible things. And yet, if he had not done all of those things, he would not have ended up where God wanted him to end up. In the beginning of the story, he has these visions and he tells people what they are. And throughout his life, it doesn't look like there's any way that those visions of his family bowing down to him are ever going to come true. Yet, they do. And when they come true, then God's power and might are made known. And so sometimes, that's why God calls us to suffer. So if we try to avoid the suffering and pain, then we may be getting in the way of God's will for our abundant life and for the abundant life of many more people. So there is something more important than our physical safety and our material comfort. So that was the first temptation. The second temptation has to do with power over people. The devil offered Jesus power over all the world, over all the kingdoms, over all the nations. The devil offers us power too, sometimes, over other people, whether over individuals or groups of people. Now, Jesus could have exerted his power over others. He could have taken the devil's deal. But he knew that was not what God wanted. He didn't want to be the kind of earthly king or Messiah that the Jewish people were expecting, one that would rule with power and might in an earthly way. Instead, he had a different kind of kingdom, a kingdom based on love, a kingdom based on servanthood, a kingdom based on giving up power. And so if we are to live like Jesus, if we are to confront that temptation in our life, we too must be willing to give up the power that we have by virtue of our station in life, maybe our education, maybe our income, maybe where we live, maybe our race. All kinds of things give us particular power. But unless we are willing to give those up, then we are succumbing to temptation. And when we do that, then we not only break relationships with other people, but we also are breaking our relationship with God. So that first temptation is about our not giving in to wanting our physical comfort above what God wants. And the second is about not exerting power over other people, but looking up to them and being a servant to them. The third temptation has to do with our relationship with God. The devil said, throw yourself off the temple and God will catch you. And Jesus said, no, because God didn't ask me to jump off. Now, if God asked me to jump off, then I would, and I would expect God to catch me. But God didn't ask me that. So I'm not going to lead and then ask God to have my back. No, I'm going to follow God. But think how often we do that in our own lives, as individuals and as a faith community. We decide what we think is best. We even convince ourselves it's what God wants. And we go to do it and we say, God's going to have us. God's going to bless us because we're doing what's right. And yet, it may not be what God wants at all. Because God usually wants something that's not reasonable or rational. I was at a worship service several weeks ago. And in the middle of the worship service, the pastor said, she was preaching, and she just said, I feel like, okay, the Holy Spirit has been telling me we need to reorient this room. And I've not been listening. But I'm getting that feeling really strong right now. We all need to get up and move our chairs so we're not facing this way, so we're facing this way. And everybody got up and moved their chair. And we all faced this other way. And she went on to say, I don't know why the Spirit's asking me to do that. I don't know why the Spirit wants us to do that. But maybe it's a test. Maybe it's a test to see that we will follow even if we don't know why. Maybe it's practice. Because maybe God is going to ask to do something that doesn't make sense to us, and yet we need to obey. Now that may sound crazy to you, but think about Jesus. He's there in the Garden of Gethsemane, and God says, "You're going to suffer and die." How is that going to do anything good? It doesn't make any sense. And yet, it did. Because only by suffering and dying was God able to raise Jesus from the dead. So those are the three temptations. The first is about ourselves, our own physical safety and material comfort. The second is about our relationships with other people and relating in a way that does not exert power over them, but acts as a servant towards them. And the third is the temptation to direct God instead of following God's direction. So those are the three temptations, and now I'm going to just look at three ways to resist them. The first temptation that Jesus had to turn the stones into bread. The devil said, Jesus said to the devil, "Humans do not live by bread alone, but by the word of God as found in Scripture." So instead of thinking about our physical safety and material comfort, we need to focus on God's word as found in Scripture. We need to read God's word, reflect on God's word, study God's word, follow God's word, obey God's word. We need to take it seriously. And we need to take it more seriously than we take other things, like our own desires. So if it comes to a choice between worshiping in a way that fulfills my personal desires versus worshiping in a way that will spread the gospel and attract more people, something I may not be comfortable with, I need to rely on Scripture and on the Great Commission to know that it's the mission of the church is to reach outside. And so that would be what would determine the choice, what we find in Scripture. The second way of resisting temptation is to listen to God in the voice of those over whom we have power or privilege. For as we listen to the least of these, we listen to Jesus. And then the third way of resisting temptation is to listen to God through prayer. It's not up to us to decide how to live our lives, or what we are to do either as individuals or as a faith community. Rather, it's up to us to discern God's will. And then once we discern God's will, we need to follow it, even if it doesn't make sense. So we have three temptations: our own physical comfort and material safety, our relationship with other people, our relationship with God, and three ways to resist temptation: by listening to God through Scripture, through prayer, and through other people. I just want to point out one more thing before I conclude. Luke talks about Jesus being filled with the Holy Spirit and being led by the Spirit into a place where he wanted to discern God's will for his life and where he encountered temptation. And there are three things I want to say about the Spirit really quickly. First, it's the Spirit that helps us identify temptation. Human beings, by and large, don't set out to do evil. Most people who do evil things think that they're not evil. I am sure that in Putin's mind, he is doing the right thing for the right reason. Now, of course, he's not doing the right thing, but he is simply unable to identify the temptation to which he has succumbed. He doesn't even see it. It is precisely because Jesus was filled with the Spirit that he could identify the two choices that lay before him. He could choose God and goodness and life, or he could choose the devil and evil and death. It's the Spirit that helps us identify the choices before us. The choice between following God and following the devil, between doing what God wants and doing what we want, between submitting to God's will and exerting our own will. So the first thing the Spirit does is help us to identify the temptation. And the second thing that the Spirit does is to help us hear God speak through prayer, through Scripture, and through other people. And then the third thing that the Spirit does is to give us the courage to do the things that God calls us to do. To face physical and material discomfort and suffering and pain and fear. To give up our power and privilege and pride in order to hear God speak through those we've been taught to see as inferior to us. And to do what God says, even if we see no rhyme or reason in it. So during this season of Lent, during these 40 days, our task is self-examination, to look inside ourselves. And today's lessons give us a way to do that, to look at the three kinds of temptations in our lives, to resist these temptations by listening to God through Scripture and prayer and the voices of other people, and to rely on the Spirit to help us to identify the choices and temptations before us, to help us discern God's will, and to give us the courage to obey God's will, no matter what is or where it leads. My prayer for each one of you, and for myself, is that our focus would be not on our own comfort, but on God's will. Not on holding on to our power, but giving it away. And not trying to lead God, but following God. May God guide each one of us on our Lenten journey. Before we end the live stream portion of our worship, I want to especially thank those of you who are out there in cyberspace who have joined us. I hope you'll join us again. If you'd like to know more about us, if you'd like to talk, if you'd like prayer, you can reach me through our Facebook page or through our website. As we say goodbye to our online worshipers, let me offer all who are worshiping with us this blessing based on today's reading from Psalm 91. Cling to God, and God will deliver you. Call upon God, and God will answer. God will uphold you and be with you in trouble. God will rescue and honor you, satisfying you with long life and offering you salvation. Amen.